Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Our King has come. God be praised. Welcome to those of you who are here at the bridge, and for those of you who are worshiping with us online, welcome as well. I've asked a friend of mine, Alex Steinauer, to help me through the course of the service today, because what we're doing is we're celebrating not only Palm Sunday. So Palm Sunday, this is one of Pastor Keel's jokes. For those of you who know Pastor Keel, it's Palm Sunday. Yes. Yeah. So if you don't have any palms, these kind, you do have these. You can lift up these kind of palms. But as we're not only celebrating Palm Sunday, but the Christian church over the last generation or so has said, you know, we really need to keep the passion history before God's people as we enter Holy Week. And so it's become a tradition in more and more churches that Palm Sunday is also Passion Sunday. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to celebrate that the King has arrived in Jerusalem, but he has arrived to die. So we'll begin our reading, our service, with the reading of the Palm Sunday account recorded in Mark chapter 11. Alex?
As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
Tony?
Thank you, Pastor. Let's stand to start our service today. Like Pastor said, if you have palm, if you have palm branches, we're going to sing a first song of joy as Jesus rides triumphant into Jerusalem and people were shouting, "Hosanna." Words will be on the screen. Let's sing with joy today.
All praise and honor, Lord, that you ride on for us. In majesty you reign with heavenly host above. Hosanna, sing. Hosanna, loud Hosanna. The little children sing through pillared court and temple. The lovely anthems ring to Jesus, who simplest and the best.
From Olivet that they followed, mid an exalted crowd, the victor palm branch waving, and chanting clear and loud, the Lord of saints and angels.
that ancient song we sing. For Christ is our Redeemer, the Lord our heaven, our King.
Be seated at this time.
So today what we want to celebrate is that the King arrived to die. And we'll use some responsive readings to help us claim and understand that. The first one is from Philippians chapter 2. Where it talks about the humiliation, the humbling of our Savior. So let's read that responsively. The King, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. You know, Alex, you just read that the King rode into Jerusalem, and there's this excitement, and the crowds are shouting, but my guess is they didn't understand things the way Jesus did. You know, the crowds probably recognized, ooh, this is fulfillment of prophecy. Here is somebody riding into Jerusalem on a donkey. You know, that they're using the Psalm 118 verses, Hosanna, you know, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Oh, this is the mighty King. This is real strength come in the person of Jesus. He is going to use his strength to defeat our enemies. But I'm quite sure that Jesus was aware of a different kind of prophecy that he was fulfilling. You see, Sunday that year was the 10th day of Nisan, which is very meaningful for all of you, right? 10th day of Nisan. Well, the 14th day of Nisan is the day of Passover, when the Passover lamb was to be sacrificed. On the 14th day of Nisan, in the evening, back in Egypt 1,500 years earlier, the Passover lamb was sacrificed, and the blood of the Passover lamb was painted over the door of the Israelites. And the angel of death in Egypt passed over the Israelite households. The firstborn of the Egyptians died, but the angel of death passed over because the angel of death saw the blood on the doorpost. So the Passover lamb was slain on the 14th, but what does that have to do with the 10th day of Nisan? Well, the 10th day of Nisan, 4 days before Passover, was the day that the Passover lamb was to be set aside for sacrifice 4 days later. I'm quite sure that Jesus was well aware of that as he rode into Jerusalem on the 10th day of Nisan, right? That he was riding into Jerusalem to show his strength in a different way. That he was riding into Jerusalem to show his strength by dying And so, as we begin the Passion History reading, Jesus, knowing very well that this is what is awaiting him, on Thursday evening prepares his disciples and himself. He prepares the disciples in the upper room for what was about to happen. And then in the Garden of Gethsemane, he prepares himself. He spends time in prayer. And he is heard. But the Father's answer is not rescue. The Father's answer is, I will strengthen you so that you can carry out your role as the Passover lamb. So let's listen to the Passion History as it's recorded in Mark chapter 14. Alex?
When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. They were saddened, and one by one they said to him, surely you don't mean me. It is one of the 12, he replied, one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born.
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take it, this is my body. Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, he said to them. Truly, I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew with you in the kingdom of God. When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Once more he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer.
The king prayed. You brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you even at my mother's breast. From birth I was cast on you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help.
As we're reading through the Passion History, it's all pointing us towards what Jesus did for us, dying on the cross. But the joy that comes from that suffering of him really gives us something to say thank you, God, for. So as we sing the song, I'm going to have us stand to sing it. Because especially at the end, when after we hear about all of the suffering that Jesus went through, all we can do is lift up a song of praise.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again.
What do you look for a king? You look for somebody who's strong enough to fight your battles. And you are looking for someone who will exercise just judgment. Jesus arrived into Jerusalem that day on Palm Sunday so many years ago to exercise judgment in a way that the people wouldn't have understood at the time. He wasn't going to use his royal power as king to punish the evildoers. Instead, the king was willing to take our place. Oh, when he was asked, "Are you the Messiah King, the Son of the Blessed?" Jesus answered, "Yes, I am." He wasn't afraid of the truth, but his own people didn't recognize him as king. Pilate asked him, "Are you king?" But Pilate knew, this isn't the kind of king that I need to be afraid of. Pilate wanted to release him, but justice was not going to be carried out that day. Injustice happened. And yet, The king arrived on Palm Sunday so that the ultimate justice could be fulfilled. God's justice. In our next Passion History lesson, we're going to see how a murderer is released and the innocent is condemned. What a marvelous picture of this substitutionary justice of our God. That the king rode into Jerusalem that day so that he, the innocent one, would be condemned, so that we, the Barabbas, the murderer, the one who is guilty and should die, that we would be set free. Human justice was not carried out that day, but the king arrived into Jerusalem to be put on trial so that God's justice would be fulfilled, so that God, as our judge, could say, you are justified, you are not guilty, because the king died for you. Let's listen to this portion of the Passion History recorded in Mark 14 and 15. Alex?
Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, Rabbi, and kissed him. The men seized Jesus and arrested him. Then one of those standing near drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Am I leading a rebellion, said Jesus, that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I was with you, teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me. But the scriptures must be fulfilled. Then everyone deserted him and fled.
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the teachers of the law came together. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for some evidence against Jesus that they could put him to death, but they could not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple made with human hands in 3 days and will build another not made with human hands. Yet even then, their testimony did not agree.
Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One? I am, said Jesus, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. The high priest tore his clothes. Why do we need any more witnesses? He asked. You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? They all condemned him as worthy of death. Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, Prophesy. And the guards took him and beat him.
Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders and the teachers of the law and the whole Sanhedrin made their plans. So they bound Jesus and led him away and handed him over to Pilate. Are you the king of the Jews? Asked Pilate. You have said so, Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again, Pilate asked him, Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of. But Jesus still made no reply. And Pilate was amazed.
Now it was the custom at the festival to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the insurrectionists who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews? Asked Pilate. Knowing it was out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him, but the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead. What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews? Pilate asked them. Crucify him, they shouted. Why? What crime has he committed? Asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, Crucify him. Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified.
Those who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, for it is written, Cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, as it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree.
So as we heard there, Jesus was and is the King that decided, to chose, to stand in our place, in our judgment, and take on all of our sins. He is our King, and He is our Savior.
Summarizes it very well. Oops. All that we're needing, He is. That summarizes it so well that if we understand who it is who died for us, It means everything. You know, all along through the Passion history, the message has been there that Jesus is the King. Did you notice as you were kind of preparing for this that the King came up a lot more than I'd realized, you know, in the Mark Passion history? But sad to say, most people didn't understand it. They didn't understand that this King was the God who had humbled himself so that he could die. It was God who died on that cross. And so the King, as he died, changed everything. All that we need, he is. Right at the end of this next lesson, Alex is going to read that the temple and the veil, or the veil in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Yeah, I pray that you always remember the Old Testament place of worship, because it's when we remember the Old Testament place of worship that we can appreciate what we have in Christ. You see, in the Old Testament, there was the tabernacle or the temple. There was the holy place. And then inside, there was a smaller room called the most holy place, or the holy of holies. And there was this veil that separated the holy place from the most holy place. And the priest could go into the holy place, but no one except the high priest could go into the most holy place behind the veil. Only one time a year, on the Day of Atonement, that the high priest could go in behind that veil. That veil symbolized the fact that the holy God who promised to dwell in a cloud above the Ark of the Covenant, that holy God could not abide with the sinfulness of mankind. There was this wall that separated us from our God. But when the King died that day, the veil was torn in two. The way to God was open. God's justice had been satisfied. Our sins had been atoned for once and for all. The King chose to die so that you and I, no matter what our sins, might have peace with God. The question is, do we recognize him as the King who could do all of that? Most of the people that day didn't. But there was a centurion who had seen many a man die, I am sure, as he saw how Jesus died that day, made a confession that I pray that we all make by our lips and by our lives. Surely, this man, this King who died, he is the Son of God. Let's listen to the Passion history as is recorded in Mark chapter 15.
It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified two rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God."
Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Do you recognize that the one who died for you is the Son of God? Do you listen to the confession of your brothers and sisters in Christ as they make that confession? "I believe that the one who died for me is the Son of God, and that I am a redeemed child of God." Do you see it? This past week has been just an incredible week. So, Friday morning, the third graders led a chapel. You can see it on our school chapel YouTube. Just look up St. Paul's School YouTube and you can find the chapel. Yeah, third grade is the first time that they do the devotions on their own, you know. Before that, the principal helps them, you know. Here's these third graders who are confessing that Jesus is the Son of God by their chapel devotion. Yesterday morning, there was an incredible number of people on this campus making something happen. There were 200-some people here for the Easter egg hunt. Kids, 200 kids. There are a lot of people making that happen. Every one of them that did, by their activity, what were they confessing? "I believe that Jesus is the King who arrived to die for me." And by the way, just to celebrate, I know at least three families. You know, why do we have an Easter egg hunt? Because it's a safe thing to invite people to. And there were non-Christian families who came. And three families have already asked for a tour of our school because of it. That's why we do it. Pretty neat. Then the last few nights, the kids have been doing their school musical, and I hope that you got a chance to see it. They just did an awesome job. But did you get to see it? Oh man, they were rocking it, man. Beautiful, beautiful singing. I think that some of them just didn't realize what a good voice God had given them. Just great to see their talents. You know, and that was marvelous, but you know what I really saw? It was not just the kids, but the parents and the teachers who gave so much of their time to make that happen. What were they confessing? "Oh, I believe that Jesus is the King, the Son of God, who died for me." Do you always see that? And then some really crazy people were hanging around after the last performance last night. Do you appreciate sitting on chairs this morning? Those of you who are here, those of you who are online, I mean, you're always sitting on a chair. But those of you who are present, you're sitting on chairs that were in the Centennial Gym about 12 hours ago. And all the sound system, we have a couple of glitches with my pack because all of that stuff, that had to be taken from the Centennial Gym up here. Why did people give so much of their time? Do you always see that? To be encouraged by that confession that here is another sister, here is another brother who has seen that the King arrived into Jerusalem to die for them. And then this morning, I walk in, and I got to take communion. I don't often get over here early enough to take communion. And by the way, that's one of the reasons why I asked Alex, because I know, Alex, you help with communion too. But there were four lay people distributing communion up here because they believe that Jesus is the King who died for them. And then I see all these people up here. And I go, wow, there's another whole bunch of people who believe that the King has arrived to suffer and die and rise again for them. You know, there's miracle workers back here and on the cameras. Do you see and hear not just the Roman centurion, but your fellow Christians who are testifying to you that they believe that that King who rode into Jerusalem that day was more than a man, that he was God who could lay down his life for our sins. That's what we believe. That's why we are here. And that's what I would invite you to join with me in confessing. So let's stand and confess together Luther's explanation of the second article of the Apostles' Creed. Alex?
I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood and with his innocent suffering and death. All this he did that I should be his own and live under him in his kingdom and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he has risen from death and lives and rules eternally. This is most certainly true.
We'll pray the response of prayer. Lord Jesus, you are the King of heaven and earth. Hosanna, save us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Gracious King, we pray for your children who worship in this place. Send us the Holy Spirit that we might always trust in you as our Savior. We pray for your church on earth. Enable Christians to live in love so that your name is glorified and your kingdom comes. We pray for our congregation. Provide us with the workers we need to carry out the mission you have given to us. Lord Jesus, let your Holy Spirit guide Pastor Matt Ewart as he considers our call to serve as our pastor of discipleship. And our principal, Seth Fitzsimmons, as he considers an invitation to leave us and serve as a principal in Florida. Be with Kim Elke, who has accepted our call to teach second grade here at St. Paul's. Bless her and during her time of transition. And let your Holy Spirit rest on Lori Andrews as she considers our call to serve as a 4K teacher here. And we pray for our nation. Grant us peace of mind that no matter who is elected, you remain as King and you will care for our nation as you know best. We pray for our world. Where there is war, may there be peace. Where there is famine and want, provide for people's needs. We pray for our brothers and sisters who are sick or hospitalized, those carrying the heavy burden of grief or anxiety. We pray especially for Wisconsin Lutheran College student Javier, whose younger brother died suddenly last week. Grant him and his family strength to bear the burden of their grief and comfort them with the hope of a blessed reunion before your heavenly throne. Mighty God, Savior God, as we come to you, confident of your power and your love. And in your name we also pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I'm thinking back to 26 years ago at this point when the first time I did a chapel service and I heard 300 kids pray the Lord's Prayer, and I came from a congregation that had about 125 in a good attendance, you know. And just to hear that, and you took me right back there today to hear God's people joining in the Lord's Prayer in that powerful way. Thank you for making that confession of the Son of God as the King who died for you. It makes an impact on the people around you. So, my dear brothers and sisters, as God's people have heard this blessing for the last 3,500 years, receive this marvelous promise from our God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Tony?
Thank you, Pastor. Our final song is a proclamation of our faith, where we can say, in Jesus' mighty name, we say it together, I believe.
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ.
I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood
place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, east of hurdle or eyes have seen. I believe that a day is coming, he's returning to claim his right. Light the altar, keep it burning. Jesus Christ, how could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? We sing that together. No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life?
Happy Palm Sunday, everybody. We'll see you back here for Holy Week.